Hi, good morning, everyone. So I'm going to talk about how you can be part of the WSRU community. So this is with the assumption that you have already decided you're willing to contribute to WSRU as an open source set of projects, and then what are the things that you could do kind of scenario. So I'm not going to talk about why you should do this, etc. I kind of explained those things to some extent yesterday in my talk in the context of economic value of open source. And then one of the things that I said is that you can contribute, take control of the community, be able to influence the community, etc. So those are some of the objectives that you can achieve by contributing. So here I'm going to focus specifically on WSRU community process and what are the things that you could do as part of the community. So we are talking about community because WSRU is open source, and then there is multiple ways of being part of this community, and obviously there's no need to explain that we are under Apache license. You should already know because you are already familiar with WSRU. So I'm not going to go into those details. However, I would like to start with the aspect of when you think about contribution, there are two main areas where you can contribute. First and foremost, the easy part is that the product is out there, the code is out there, the documentation is out there. You can start as a user and see what you can do in the context of user, and while using the products for your use, how you can be part of the community contribute to the community. And then if you have time, if you want to get into more advanced things, and if you're passionate about being part of the code base, then you also have an opportunity to operate in the developer mode and be part of the community as a developer. So there are two dimensions that you can participate in the community. So what I'm going to do is to explain each and every area in the context of the two main modes of operation, and try and give you some understanding in terms of what are the entry points that you can explore, and then obviously you can start from those points and start contributing. So looking at the user base, the first aspect is that you can use the products. Obviously when you go to WSRU, there are multiples of products that you can deal with. Obviously, we'll start with the product that you want to use and the product that you have the use case for. And then in the context of using the product, if you try and understand the space of WSRU, there are basic use cases, there are advanced use cases, and then you have the multiple questions to be answered, how to find documentation. When you talk about cross products such as API Manager, then there are relevant components of these products such as the Key Manager, the Gateway, etc. Then what are the relevant versions of those identity server components or ESB server components that you have to use? So as a user, you might have to have some basic understanding of those aspects. So you can get into the product space, try and understand the products, and then there's documentation. Obviously, I have to admit that our documentation is not the perfect in the perfect world it should be. However, the fact is that we are on a continuous mode of operation in order to improve. But then at the same time, we have a library within WSRU where people write about various use cases, samples, etc., etc. And then there are a lot of blogs also that most of our developers within WSRU and also external users do around this. And then if you want to understand the product release metrics, you can go to the release metrics page and understand the carbon platform versions related to a particular product, and then understand the related product versions if you want to use other components in relation to the product. So this is just the base of using the product, and try and be part. That's the initial entry point in order to get into the community aspect. And then if you want to understand more about it, you might have to talk to people, you might have to understand what's going on, you might want to read about news, you might want to have more details, you might want to ask questions, then one of the things that you could do is to attend events. We have an events page in our website that gets regularly updated, and there are various kinds of events that we host as WSO2. The most popular one and most easy one to attend is webinars. Webinars, you can be either the same time live and attend a webinar, and the advantage of that is to you get the chance of asking questions from the people who are present in the webinar. And of course, we record the webinars and host, and then you can watch those webinars not live format. Only disadvantage being is that you don't get to talk to someone when you're doing that. And then we do workshops. We obviously do WSO2Con, where we get to meet and talk about issues that you face, and then information that you want to discuss. And then there are other conferences other than WSO2 that we attend, we participate. If you happen to attend those events, you can meet us and talk to us in those events too. We conduct trainings, various trainings on various subjects, and also our partners have partner events where you can again attend and understand more about WSO2. So if you visit event page, you can get some understanding in terms of what are the events that are available that you can attend and get information about. So you can start using the product, you can start discussing and by attending events, etc. And then when you get into the serious things, you can participate in forums. We don't have a mailing list, a user mailing list. Our default mode of operation is to use Stack Overflow. one of the key advantages of Stack Overflow is that if you Google for something related to WSO2, the first thing that you would find probably is Stack Overflow, even beyond our documentation. One of the challenges would be that not all Stack Overflow queries that you get in there might have been already answered, kind of scenario, right? However, if you want to contribute rather than using the community just as a user who wants to raise questions, you can also start helping other people. Now, this is the secondary aspect of the user community. You will become a helping user to other people and thereby be part of the community. So if you go to WSO2 tag, you can find almost every WSO2 related queries that you get in Stack Overflow, obviously with the assumption that the users who raise the queries have tagged it properly, kind of scenario. And if you want to find like who are the people who might know about WSO2 related things, so that you can go directly to those people in the community aspect, you can go to this link where it lists the top users. That shows who are the people who ask the questions most and who are the people who respond the questions most. Now, the advantage here is that this is community. It has nothing to do with WSO2 employment or something like that. Those are the people who know about WSO2 who happen to answer, and some of those people happen to be WSO2 employees, but that's the community aspect. It's not directly related to the WSO2 employment aspect. So there are two modes of operation, obviously, in here. You can ask questions, you can answer questions. Then the next level, a bit more advanced, is that, okay, you try to use it, you try to figure it out, whether it works, and then you run into problems. Obviously, you can report bugs, right? So we have the open bug tracking system based on Jira, and almost every project that we run is listed in in here. You can list all the projects that we run, and you can jump into the project that you are interested in and see what are the bugs already reported. And if you want to report bugs, you can report them. And then our release process is open source release process. So we are supposed to fix all L1s before we release, and we are supposed to cut down the bug count as much as possible before we release. And then it's open so that people know what's broken, what is already reported, et cetera, et cetera. You can also keep an eye on what are the fixing trends that are happening, what is the reporting trend, and what is the resolution trend that is happening in terms of the products. So if you go to this link, it will list all the Jira projects for the various products that we have. And then the other thing is that we also have a documentation JIRA, which is again in the JIRA setup, where you can report bugs related to documentation in terms of what is missing, what are the bugs in documentation, and what is not documented can all be reported in here. And our tech content team, alongside the product teams, also work on resolving these documentation JIRAs on priority basis. So that's the user mode, the four main areas that you as a user can participate in the community. Then let's look at a bit more advanced things, such as if you want to hack code and if you want to provide fixes, what are the things that you might want to do in that process? Now, before hacking code, I spoke about the training events that WSO2 has. As of late, we have changed our training strategy and started putting all our training material online. So our the presentations, our training labs, as well as our videos are in GitHub. So you can go to this link in GitHub and find all the material that is there. If you are willing to add training that can help other people, it's open source under Creative Commons license. If you are willing to contribute material under that license, you can give it to people. And obviously, if there are issues, bugs, missing elements that you find in the training material that is already available, you can contribute via GitHub to those things. And then you can also discuss training-related factors in this particular list, training at wso2.com, and people will respond to you if you have concerns, if you have contributions, if you have ideas. You can share all those via this particular mailing list. Then, as I said, we don't have user mailing lists in WSO2. Our primary user forum is Stack Overflow, where you can ask questions and respond. But we have mailing lists for development discussions as well as architecture discussions, right? So these are the two main mailing lists that we have in WSO2. And our developers, when they are in development mode and want to discuss things, they use the dev@wso2.org discussion list. You can look at the mail archives from here. You can subscribe for yourself and see what discussions are going on and participate in discussions, etc. And then all our architectural decisions are made on architecture at wso2.org, where we discuss the overall architecture happens here. You can look at the archives also in here in terms of what is happening. So if you want to, for example, to understand where DAS is going, where C5 is, Carbon 5 is going, where container-related architecture is going, they should all be discussed in here, right? That's the idea. So those are the two main main developer and architecture-related mailing lists that you have. But if you are interested in more stuff, such as is the build failing, is the build passing, who is committing, what are the commits happening, what is happening with bugs, are they being fixed, are they not being fixed. And if you are just interested in figuring out what are the announcements, what are the releases coming out, etc., there are various lists for those various purposes within WSO2. They are all listed here in this particular URL, so you can pick and choose what to subscribe to and keep an eye if you wish to. So these lists are more informative rather than contribution-oriented. These are the two mailing lists, the developer list and the architecture list, is more contribution-oriented. You can discuss things, you can complain about things, you can contribute ideas in those lists because it is open if you are willing to. The other lists that I listed here are information-driven. Like if you are interested in keeping an eye in terms of what is happening, you can keep an eye on these lists. So the next level is that you can contribute to extensions. If you have heard about our store, especially for the ESB and the Identity Server, Enterprise Service Bus and the Identity Server products, we have the notion of connectors, the cloud connectors that you can use on top of the ESB or Identity Server connections, connectors that you can use for extending the identity server capabilities, etc. They are all listed here. This is a public store. You can contribute to these connectors, which are written on top of the product, which is not really part of the product. You are extending the product. And you can contribute it back to the community if you think that they are useful for other people to be used, etc. So it already has a bunch of connectors which are written by WSRU and some other people. But it is also a community engagement point that you can participate in if you wish to. Malika will later talk more about how exactly to participate in here. So I have given the URLs in terms of the store is the public interface of where we host this stuff for users to download, etc. And then all the code for these extensions are available in WSRU extensions repository. And then in terms of if you want to understand how to write ESB connectors or identity server connectors or authenticators, you can look into these documentation and understand how those should be done. Then last but not least is the idea of being able to participate to the code base, right? So what are the forms that you can participate in when it comes to the core code of WSO2? So again, like I listed in the Jira, we have bunch of projects that are running, and it is based on the carbon architecture. So each and every product has its own set of components, and all the of them are in this GitHub repo if you go there. And then you can find the source code for all these GitHub repos. And then you can decide whether to provide code fixes, etc., into the main code base. So there are multiple ways of doing this. The first would be that if you understand that there are bugs that you would like to get fixed, and if you know how to fix it, you can provide fixes into the existing bugs and existing code that you have. That's one form of contribution that is possible. And then the other form of contribution is that you can write new components, new product-related extensions, extensions in the sense that not in the extension sense that I discussed earlier, but rather like how we extend the carbon platform is to write new OSGI components that deliver various functionalities, right? So Krishanthan will later describe in his presentation how to extend the carbon platform as the core platform. So you can do that sort of contribution too in here. So there are some guidelines that are listed in this particular GitHub IO URL, where how you could fork the code, how we can build the stuff, and then how you can fix something, and how you can send a pull request to us, and how you can list that in Jira, etc. Right? There's a little bit of process how you would do that. And at a particular point in time, if you decide that you are interested in writing code for WSRU code base and you want to contribute, the notion of a contributor license agreement comes into play. This is a well-known phenomena if you are part of Apache community or if you are part of Eclipse community, and if you want to write code for them, you have to agree to the fact that the code that you write, that you are willing to contribute to that community, right? So if you don't want to get into the dilemma of who has the right to use this code, who has the copyright to use this code, etc., and you want to openly contribute your code, it is up to you to decide. But if you decide that you would like to do that, you can sign the contributor license agreement. I have given you the URL for you to read and understand what the license is all about. And you can have a decision on your own in terms of you want to do that kind of scenario. But it is in keeping with the open source licensing nature, where when you write some code, you expect the fact that you are willing to give that code back to the community with the same license kind of stuff, right? That's the idea in here. So those are the main things that you can do in the space of contributing to the WSRU community aspect. You either as a user or as a developer, in either mode, you can contribute to these various aspects that I listed here using the various information channels that I provided you. And if you want another overall overview of all these options that are available. You can visit that particular link that I have given here, and that will list out all the options. It might not have all the links that I provided you, but it will have a write-up in terms of describing. I will share this presentation, and it has all the links for you to dig deeper into the details of the aspects that I discussed. So that is all that I have to discuss this morning in terms of contribution. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take. And then the next two sessions are more about going in detail in terms of how to write code at the carbon architecture layer, and then how to write code at the extensions layer on top of products.